Let's move to the next talk by Tamayuki again. And this time, the topic will be quantum advantage from one-way functions.
Thank you for the introduction. Sorry for appearing again. So this is again joint work with Takashi Yamakawa. Okay. So quantum advantage is the existence of some hard problem, which is easy for quantum but hard for classical. And so we have some problem, very difficult problem, and this is very hard for classical efficient algorithm. So no PPT algorithm, probabilistic polynomial time algorithm, can solve this problem. But on the other hand, there are some QPT algorithm, quantum polynomial time algorithm, that can solve this problem. And if such problem exists, we say that quantum advantage exists. Okay? And there are three approaches to demonstrate quantum advantage. One is sampling, the other one is searching, and also proofs of quantumness. So now I explain each of them separately. So first approach is sampling. The goal of sampling is to sample some distribution. So you run some efficient quantum algorithm that output some bit string according to some distribution. And the goal is to sample this distribution. And classically, it's not possible. So no PPT algorithm can sample this. So if I run some classical efficient algorithm, my output distribution is far from this one. But on the other hand, quantum algorithm can sample this distribution. This is a quantum advantage. Sorry, sampling advantage. And the second approach is search type advantage. The goal of search problem is to find some answer that satisfies some relation. And again, classical case, you cannot solve this. So no PPT algorithm can find the answer. But on the other hand, there are some quantum algorithms that can find answer. And in this case, we say a search advantage exists. And the third approach is proofs of quantumness. So this is some interactive protocol between prover and verifier. So verifier is PPT, probabilistic polynomial time algorithm. And they exchange only classical message. And we require two properties, completeness and soundness. So if prover is QPT algorithm, verifier accept with high probability. This is completeness. And soundness means for any PPT prover, verifier doesn't accept. Verifier reject with high probability. This is soundness. And if this both completeness and soundness are satisfied, this is called proofs of quantumness. So in this way, we have three approaches. And ideally, we want to show the existence of quantum advantage unconditionally. So without introducing any assumption, we want to show the existence of quantum advantage. But this is extremely difficult, and beyond our understanding of current complexity theory, current understanding of complexity theory. But by the way, there are some unconditional separation between quantum and classical, but these results restrict classical computation. So they show that some problem is difficult for example, constant depth classical algorithm or log depth classical computation. But here we are interested in any general efficient classical computation, so any polynomial time classical computation. And in this case, separation is, unconditional separation is highly non-trivial, and we don't know how to do that. And because of this, we need some computational assumption. And the question is, what assumption should we use? So maybe I can define some my own new conjecture about hardness of some problem. And maybe I can show quantum advantage based on this. But this is not so interesting. But on the other hand, maybe we could show the existence of quantum advantage based on some standard weak assumption, like p is not equal to np or a function exists. And in this case, very nice. This is very fantastic. Okay. And second point that is important in quantum advantage is verifiability. So verifiability means we have some quantum machine and we want to verify that this is actually quantum advantage. So classical verifier want to verify that this machine really show some quantum advantage. This is verifiability. And this is a summary of previous results. So we have three approaches, sampling, searching, and proof of quantumness. And in terms of assumption and verifiability, all these results are not so satisfactory. So for example, sampling case, assumption is some newly introduced one, like hardness, Sharpe hardness of approximating some value and so on. So that's new assumption, which was not studied before. And also for verifiability, in general, we don't know how to verify sampling advantage. And for searching case, again, we have to introduce some new assumption, or we have to rely on random oracle. But for verifiability, this is slightly better than sampling, because at least we can inefficiently verify quantum advantage. So given answer by spending exponentially long classical time, we can verify that this answer satisfies the relation. So this is at least inefficiently verified. And for proofs of quantumness, assumptions are relatively nice. So for example, we know that proof of quantumness can be constructed from noisy trapdoor Clough-Free function, or full domain trapdoor permutation, or quantum homomorphic encryption, or random oracles. And also verifiability is very nice because by definition, this is efficiently verified. So verifier is PPT algorithm, and this verifier can efficiently verify the existence of quantum advantage. But still, we have the following open question. So can we demonstrate quantum advantage, verifiable, efficiently verifiable quantum advantage from some standard assumption, like one existence of one-way function? And our result partially give some answer to this open question. So our result is the following one. So first, we introduce new concept, which we call inefficient verifier proofs of quantumness, which I explain later. And we show that this can be constructed from classically secure one-way function. So here only classical security is enough because soundness of proof of quantumness is only against classical prover. And this classical secure one-way function is a minimum assumption in classical cryptography. So we could show quantum advantage based on some minimum assumption in classical cryptography. And unfortunately, our IVPOQ is not efficiently verifiable. So verifier should be inefficient. But this is at most BPP to NP. And I explain what is this IVPOQ, inefficient verifier proof of quantumness. And this is very similar to POQ, proof of quantumness. So we have verifier, PPT verifier, and also prover. And they exchange classical message. But the crucial difference from POQ is final verification is done by some another unbounded verifier. So this message, all sequence of message exchanged in the first interactive round is sent to the other verifier, which could be unbounded. And this verifier makes decision, accept or reject. This is a crucial difference from proof of quantumness. But because of this, this IVPOQ capture all previous approach of quantum advantage, including sampling, searching, and efficiently verifiable POQ. And our result has interesting consequence. So what we have shown is this one. Classically secure, if classically secure one-way function exists, then IVPOQ exists. this is our result. And if we take the contraposition of this statement, what we get is the following one. So if IVPOQ do not exist, then classically speaking, one function do not exist. And as I have said, classically speaking, one function is a minimum assumption in classical cryptography. So this means if there is no quantum advantage, then there is no classical cryptography. So this is some interesting connection between quantum advantage and classical cryptography. Okay, so again, I emphasize this. So if there is no quantum advantage, then there is no classical cryptography. Okay. So now I explain a construction of IVPOQ from one-way function. So our construction is based on the previous construction of POQ by this paper. So they used a trapdoor Clough-Free function, and their construction is the following one. So first, the verifier choose trapdoor and F0, F1. They are, Clough-Free trapdoor function. And this F0 and F1 are sent to the prover, and the prover generates this quantum state. And the prover measure this third register in the computational basis, and after the measurement, the state becomes this one, the superposition of X0 and X1. And this X0 and X1 are Clough for Y. And after generating this quantum state, they exchange some more classical message. And finally, this verifier accepts with high probability. And the soundness comes from the fact that this prover cannot run both X0 and X1. So this is because this is a Clough-free function. So classically speaking, a Clough-free function. So no PPT prover can find both X0 and X1. So that's why we can show the soundness here. This is their construction proof of quantumness. And we use this. So our idea is the following one. So we start with a classically secure one-way function, which is equivalent to classical commitment, statistically hiding and computational binding commitment. And from this commitment, so somehow we quantize this commitment, which I explain later. And also we combine POQ, which I explained in the previous slide. And finally, we get IVPOQ. So this is our idea. So now I explain what do I mean by quantization of classical commitment. So this is just the general description of classical commitment. So we have PPT receiver and PPT sender. And so because this is PPT, first you can choose classical random seed in advance. And just you can learn classical deterministic algorithm. So receiver first choose random seed R, and also sender choose a bit that he wants to commit, and also random seed X. Then they exchange message, commitment, and the sequence of this message is just a commitment. So after the interaction, they have a transcript, which is a sequence of message exchanged. And this transcript is just a commitment. And in the opening phase, this sender sends random seed that he has chosen. This is the opening. This is just a general description of classical commitment. And now I explain what is quantization. So here, sender is QPT, and the sender first generates a superposition of bit B and also random seed X. And then they do commitment. So this is just a classical message. And this receiver is completely classical. But this sender runs his protocol in a coherent way. So first he generates superposition of all random seed, and then he ran classical protocol in a coherent way. And at the end of interaction, finally, what the sender gets is this quantum state. So this is a random seed corresponding to bit zero, committed bit zero, and transcript T. And this is a superposition of all random seed corresponding to committed bit one and also transcript T. So at the end of interaction, this sender gets this quantum state. And if this is equivalent to this one, then we just, our construction is finished. Because now from here, we can learn this KMCVY protocol. But unfortunately, as you can see, in general, this state is not equivalent to this one. Because this is just only one single x0, but here we have many superpositions. Okay. So in general, still, this is not proof of quantumness. Okay. And so the idea to solve this issue is we use a hash technique. So this means, so after the interaction, sender has this quantum state, and then receiver sends some pairwise independent hash function. And then sender construct this quantum state. So he coherently compute this h of x, and he measure this register. And if the measurement result is u, the state after measurement is this. So now we have superposition of all x that is a random seed corresponding to committed bit zero and also transcript t and also preimage of this u. And also here we have similar superposition random seed. And then because of statistical hiding and also by using some similar technique that was used by Variant and Bajirani, we can show that with enough probability, the size of this set is actually equal to one. And in this case, this state is just this state. So now we have only superposition of two states, x0 and x1. And once we get this quantum state, we can just learn KMCVY proof of quantumness. Okay. So prover is this sender, and verifier is this receiver. And for soundness, we use the fact that this commitment is a computational binding. So if you remember, the KMCVY protocol, their KMCVY protocol is sound because of the crow-free property, classical prover cannot find both x0 and x1. So this comes from the crow-free property of their function. But on the other hand, here we can show that this prover cannot find both this x0 in this set and this x1 in this set. And this comes from the binding of the base classical bit commitment. Because if a sender or prover can find both this x0 and x1, he gets two openings for both message 0 and message 1. This means binding properties broken. So that's why he cannot get both this x0 and x1 at the same time. And by using that fact, we can show the soundness in a similar way as this KMCVY protocol. So in this way, we can construct proof of quantumness that satisfy completeness and soundness. And finally, I explain the verifiability. So unfortunately, this is not efficiently verifiable because so in KMCVY case, they used a trapdoor function. And by using trapdoor, verifier can compute preimage. But here, we don't have any trapdoor, so verifier here, this verifier cannot compute this x0 and x1 inefficiently because we don't have any trapdoor. But at least by running some BPP to NP algorithm, she can find both x0 and x1. So that's why verifier is inefficient here. Okay. So in summary, we defined inefficient verifier proof of quantumness, which is very similar to proof of quantumness, but verifier becomes unbounded time at the final stage. And we constructed this IVPOQ from classical secure one-way functions, which is a minimum assumption in classical cryptography. And this IVPOQ is not efficiently verifiable, but at least this is inefficiently verifiable with the power of BPP to NP. And this result, IVPOQ from one-way function, again implies this interesting connection between classical cryptography and quantum advantage. So if there is no quantum hard voltage, then there is no classical cryptography. Okay. And finally, I mentioned open problems. So first open problem is whether we can construct proof of quantumness from one-way function. So here what we constructed is the inefficient verifier proof of quantumness. But original POQ is efficiently verifiable one. And our question is whether we can construct efficiently verifiable POQ from one-way functions. So, so far, all known constructions are just some LWE or trapdoor or something like that. So question is whether we can construct POQ from one-way function. Or maybe we can show that this is impossible. For example, POQ imply key exchange, and maybe because we cannot construct key exchange from one-way function, so maybe this shows that POQ is cannot be constructed from one function or something like that. And also third open question is whether we can construct IVPOQ from some weaker assumption than one way function. For example, can we construct IVPOQ from P is not equal to B or something like that. Okay. So this is the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
All right, questions? Thanks for the talk. So can you comment why you need BPP to NP and not just NP or MA?
Yeah. Okay, so the reason is, okay, so here, you have to find this element here. And in order to do that, okay, so I don't remember the algorithm now, so maybe I can explain later, but at least the reason why we need BPP to NP is you have to query NP oracle many times to find this X0 and X1. Yeah, maybe I can explain details later.
Other questions?
Thank you for the talk. In your construction, you consider the inefficiently verifiable, which requires the heavy post-processing. What if we consider heavy pre-processing? Did you ever consider this kind of thing? I think it's somewhere practical in a sense.
That's a very interesting question. So you mean, so first the verifier does some long computation, and after that, they start interaction.
Yes.
And the final verification is also efficient.
Yes.
Yeah, but so I don't know, but all known constructions of POQ require to find some pre-image. And in that case, you have to do inefficient computation after this transcript is generated. But that's a very interesting idea.
Thank you.
Do you have more questions? If not, I'll ask one. I'm curious about your last open question, which is to build this POQ based on weaker assumptions. I suppose the reason you need one function is to come up with that statistically hiding commitment. I guess, is that possible from, say, EFI?
From EFI. Mm.
I suppose that's okay.
Yeah. Because EFI also imply commitment?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. But usually your commitment is a quantum communication commitment.
Correct.
This means verifier should also be quantum. So yeah, commitment, what you get from EFI is quantum communication commitment. So if I just directly use that, verifier should also be quantum. So that's why this doesn't work. Maybe at least if you can construct classical communication commitment.
Something like that.
Yeah, then at least we get a quantum verifier proof of quantumness. So now verifier is quantum. But But still, communication is classical.
True.
But I don't know how to get classical communication commitment from EFI.
Okay, cool. Yeah, we can talk more. Any other questions? Yes.
Hi, I have a quick question. How do interactive verifier proof of quantumness relate to sampling based proofs of quantumness? Like, does one imply the other?
Okay, very good question. And actually, that contains some our unpublished work. So, somehow, so very intuitively, so Aronson showed that sampling advantage is equivalent to search advantage. So sample BQP is equal to sample BPP is equivalent to FBQP is equal to FBPP. So if you have a sampling advantage, you have also have a search advantage. Search advantage is just a non-interactive IVP of Q. Is that okay?
Thank you so much. Yes. Okay.
Do you have more questions? If not, let's thank Tamayuki again.